Hey there once again, YouTube. Please utilize the parts section below if this video is a little bit too long for you. Now, if you don't already know, my name is Ben Ferraiuolo. I also have a website with a link posted in the description box below right under my email address. It can teach you how to find, access, and analyze seismic and GPS deformation data, how to understand the many seismic plots that people use, and even, contains hundreds of plots generated by myself using the seismic program Swarm, the program shown here, for a great many different earthquake swarms and events. I did just recently upload two videos, actually. One on how to analyze seismic data in the program seen here, Swarm, and how to find and access seismic data directly from the seismic instruments themselves from across the world. I'm also going to be updating some things on my website over the next week, including some mistakes that I made in the past. The earthquake statistics page under the More drop-down menu is getting a big overhaul. That's not completed yet, but it will be much more accurate when I'm finished with it, and I'll let you guys know when that happens. Today I'm going to be talking about two recent earthquakes that struck off the coast of Vancouver Island in the same location that has been filled with seismicity over the past year. The same location saw swarm a magnitude 6 earthquakes, including one almost reaching magnitude 7. However, today, there were only a few quakes, with one being reported as a magnitude 5.5 and a magnitude 4.6. The data streams shown here, shown as a spectrogram, are taken directly from the seismic instruments themselves from around Vancouver Island via the program Swarm. In this video, I'm going to take a look at the seismic data from the closest seismic station to the increase in seismicity. And by the way, notice guys, I do have a 1 Hz high pass filter, so these are not really background microseisms. There is something occurring between 1 Hz to 5 Hz on Holb and BPEB, and you'll see where those stations are in just a second. But from the swarm epicenter, Holb seems like it is the closest station to the earthquake swarm and increase in seismicity that occurred today and in past weeks and months as well. But notice how these are all the way south. Notice this one is farther south than this one. This one's farther south than this one. As the farther we get south, this background tremor, or this low-frequency tremor, I don't know what it is, it gets weaker and weaker and weaker. And it does seem to coincide with surrounding stations, showing that there is some type of strange background tremor coming from the possible epicenter, because Holb was the closest station. It's showing it the tremor the strongest. The farther you get south, it seems to get weaker and weaker and weaker. And if it was long-distance microseisms, which can be caused by the ocean waves and other things as well, it would not act like that. So I don't know what that means. I personally have not seen this or really studied it much before. To me, it is exactly what it looks like in volcanic hazard areas when there's like harmonic volcanic tremor. But obviously that's not the case unless there's like an underwater erupting volcano. I'm not saying that there is, guys. But then again, there's so many underwater volcanoes that erupt all the time. So, but before I get into that, let me just go to something else just real quick. Let me update this, just refresh it just real quick. This is the recent hourly tremor map. Notice how we do have another ETS event going on. It has been going off and on in the same location for about the past month or so. About a month, month and a half. 2 hours of tremor in the past 3 hours. That's pretty high. That's pretty high. These are not errors. Sometimes you can see errors on here, but these are not. Some weird ETS event is happening, but it's acting differently than any other ETS event before. It's occurring. And then it stops the next day, and then occurs, and then stops the next day. It is very strange. Even some of the people at PNSN did say that it's very odd, very weird how it's acting right now. But we are approaching in the next few months the next ETS episode, which is supposed to hit. Maybe this is just a precursor to that. This is the past 3 hours as of 9:24 p.m. Pacific time, April 22nd, 2019. The past 6 hours, we see 3.2 hours of tremor, which is a little bit more than half of the 6 hours. Past 12 hours, we see 4.3. Not as much, right? 24 hours, we see 12.5. That's about half. Notice how it's kind of going on and off, on and off, on and off. It's weird. Usually ETS tremor events, episodic tremor and slip, which I'll talk about in just a second, usually those events just happen, and they just keep going and going and going, and then just kind of die off after about a month or so, or however long. But this has been acting very strange. 27 hours of tremor in the past 48 hours, the past 2 days. You'll see it load. My computer's a little bit slow. Sorry, guys. And all of the ETS that is being recorded in this area right here. an area notorious for episodic tremor and slip in the past. We do have a little bit of ETS events occurring up here on the southern tip of Vancouver Island. So, that's the past 48 hours in the hourly tremor map. We are seeing an ETS event as we speak right now. Now, if you don't know what episodic tremor and slip is, let's just take a look at an article real quick. It's from Wikipedia, and I don't really like to use Wikipedia too much for my research, but they really do have a good piece on ETS events. An article about ETS on Wikipedia. Episodic tremor and slip, ETS, is a seismological phenomenon observed in some subduction zones that is characterized by non-earthquake seismic rumbling or tremor and slow slip along the plate interface. The tremor, guys, is recorded by seismic stations. The slow slip is recorded by the GPS stations. Those two together is how they discovered ETS. Slow slip events are distinguished from earthquakes by the propagation speed and focus. In slow slip events, there is an apparent reversal of crustal motion, although the fault motion remains consistent with the direction of subduction. ETS events themselves are imperceptible to human beings and do not cause damage. Now, they say they're imperceptible to human beings, but that's probably because if human beings felt them, or at least felt the effects from them, they probably wouldn't have even guessed that that's what it is. So really, even if humans really could perceive the small movement that is occurring, I mean, the movement is large, guys. It's not small. But when we feel it, we probably feel it every day and we don't even notice when these ETS events are happening. I mean, they're happening right now. I don't feel a thing. But there are some people out there who are very susceptible to vibrations and slow movements. So you don't know. That is not 100% that human beings cannot feel them. We don't know that yet. Non-volcanic episodic tremor was first identified in southwest Japan in 2002. Shortly after, the Geological Survey of Canada coined the term episodic tremor and slip to characterize observations of GPS measurements in the Vancouver Island area. Vancouver Island, which is where the recent earthquakes have occurred, a little bit of tremor is occurring on the southern tip of Vancouver Island, but the majority of it is occurring in Washington State right now. But again, Vancouver Island lies in the eastern North American region of the Cascadia subduction zone, just north of Washington State. ETS events in Cascadia were observed to reoccur cyclically with a period of approximately 14 months. And we are about to enter that 14-month window in just the end of next month, that is when we enter that 14-month window. And we have been seeing ETS going off and on, off and on. So it could be starting right now, guys. It could be starting because, of course, nothing holds a perfect record. I mean, of course, geological things can carry a near-perfect rhythm, but it will be a little bit random here and there. Kind of like Steamboat Geyser, right? It was holding a nearly one-week perfect schedule, but it would differ a little bit. Sometimes it'd be 6 hours late, sometimes it'd be 12 hours early, you know, but still, it would be near that time. Now, these events are marked by about 2 weeks of 1 to 10 hertz seismic trembling. That's low-frequency tremor, guys. And non-earthquake aseismic slip on the plate boundary, equivalent to a magnitude 7 earthquake. So people wonder why the Cascadia subduction zone, compared to other subduction zones, does not have the magnitude 7 earthquakes. I mean, of course we do have them every now and then, but comparing Cascadia subduction zone to, let's say, the Japan Trench subduction zone and the one in Mexico and Chile, they get far more magnitude 7s and 8s than we do. But they still do have some type of silent slip, kind of like ETS. But mainly, tremor has been observed mainly on the West Coast, or the Cascadia subduction zone. So maybe the fact that tremor is there has to do, and they did say in this article that it could have to do with lubrication. That's why we don't have magnitude 7 earthquakes, but these ETS events are equivalent to a magnitude 7. So it's still releasing the stress, but still, in my opinion, could increase the chance of a larger earthquake, at least in my opinion. Tremor is a weak seismological signal, only detectable by very sensitive seismometers. Recent episodes of tremor and slip in Cascadia have occurred down dip of the region, ruptured by the 1700 Cascadia earthquake, which happened 319 years ago. Whoo! Long time, guys. Now, slip behavior in the Cascadia subduction zone, the Juanfica Plate, a relic of the ancient Farallon Plate, supposedly, is actively subducting eastward underneath the North American Plate. The boundary between the Juan de Fuca and North American plates is generally locked due to interplate friction. A GPS marker on the surface of the North American plate above the locked region will trend eastward as it is dragged by the subduction process. And I will leave a link to this in the description box below, guys. I'm not going to read this entire thing, but I am going to read a little bit of it. Now, the tremor part of it. Slow slip events are frequently linked to non-volcanic seismological rumbling, or tremor. Tremor is distinguished from earthquakes in several key respects: frequency, duration, and origin. Seismic waves generated by earthquakes are high frequency. Well, unless they're low frequency earthquakes, but usually, yeah, much higher frequency and short-lived. Short-lived, that depends, guys. We've been seeing some long, drawn-out, slightly lower frequency earthquakes as of late, so that's not 100% all the time. But these characteristics allow seismologists to determine the hypocenter of an earthquake using first arrival methods. In contrast, seismic signals are weak and extended in duration. Furthermore, while earthquakes are caused by the rupture of faults, tremor is generally attributed to the underground movement of fluids, magma, or hydrothermal fluids. As well as in subduction zones, tremor has been detected in transform faults, such as San Andreas. In both the Cascadia and Nankai subduction zones, slow slip events are directly associated with tremor. In the Cascadia subduction zone, slip events and seismological tremor signals are spatially and temporally coincident, but this relationship does not extend to the Mexican subduction zone. Furthermore, this association is not an intrinsic characteristic of slow slip events. In the Hikuriangai, subduction zone, New Zealand, episodic tremor and slip events are associated with distinct reverse faulted micro earthquakes. So it's a little bit different each subduction zone you go to, guys. A little bit different. Two types of tremor have been identified. One associated with geodetic deformation, as described above, and one associated with 5 to 10 second bursts excited by distant earthquakes. The second type of tremor has been detected worldwide. For example, it was triggered in the San Andreas Fault by the 2002 Denali earthquake and in Taiwan by the 2001 Kunlun earthquake. Now, the geological interpretation is tremor is commonly associated with the underground movement of magmatic or hydrothermal fluids, harmonic volcanic tremor, other tremor associated with that, maybe even tremor from lahar flows. As a plate is subducted into the mantle, it loses water from its pore space, and due to phase changes of hydrous minerals, such as amphibole, I believe that's what you call it. It has been proposed that this liberation of water generates a supercritical fluid at the plate interface, lubricating plate motion. That is the reason, in my opinion, that the Cascadia subduction zone sees far less large magnitude earthquakes before a megathrust subduction earthquake than other places do. Because you can see Japan can have multiple sevens, multiple eights without there being an actual megathrust event. You know what I'm saying? Same with Chile. Chile sees sevens all the time. I mean, they get hit hard down there. But us up here, we're very blessed, guys. We are very lucky that we have lubricating plate motion. So at night, when you're saying your prayers, please thank God for the lubricating plates. Really, though, in a way, it got some truth in it. Also, if you want some updated reports from the Pacific Northwest Seismic Network about the recent ETS events and the main one that we are about to enter in this next few months, then please come here to pnsn.org/blog. I will leave, of course, a link to it in the description box below. Now, some of the things that they say in their posts are kind of humorous, and they do correct some errors that they made. Seems like professionals can make mistakes too. Now, we are all human, guys. Well, at least most of us. Now, before I get into the earthquakes on the West Coast, there was a small earthquake on the East Coast of the United States, as you see right here, is a magnitude 1.7, 19 kilometers south-southeast of Gloucester, Massachusetts, at 5.0 kilometers in depth. As we can see, here's Boston, Massachusetts, and here's the location of the earthquake right here, probably within a few latitude and longitude, probably around this area somewhere, but I believe the location of the earthquake is correct. As you can see, it occurred in Massachusetts Bay. I believe that's what this area is called. There's Boston, that's the location. Let's go to the event page real quick. Now, here's the event page for the magnitude 1.7 at 5.0 kilometers in depth in Massachusetts Bay, just east of Boston. Looks like nobody reported feeling this, and there's no other information they're giving us at all about this earthquake except the magnitude, depth, location, time, and date. Let's go to origin and see what the closest seismic station is to this earthquake, shall we? Go to phases, click arrival time once. NEBCX HHZ00. So let's check that out on the seismic program swarm just real fast. Now here we are on the seismic program swarm with station BCX in the NE network broadband vertical 00 location code, which was supposedly the closest seismic station to this event. We see persistor rescale is off, overlap is set to 95 for the spectrogram, and I'm going to set a high pass enable 1 Hz to the 8th power filter. Press OK. All right. So they say that this earthquake occurred on April 22nd, 2019 at 2208. So let's say 2209, 3 seconds ahead, 8.6 seconds. So we should see it at about probably 2209.05 or so. That's when it arrived on the station, 2209.05. Yep, it's this one right here. Notice you can barely see the P wave at 2209.05, the exact time they said it would occur. Notice the P wave's right there, dies down a little bit. We got the S wave right here as well. Let's go right here. You cannot see one thing at all because the frequencies, something's just going on right here, guys. It's just, there's some strange background activity. So I'm going to cut this out to draw it out. I'm going to do a band pass filter instead of a high pass filter. Do 1 Hz. Let's see. It doesn't start to about 5 Hz. So let's do 5 Hz to 18 Hz. This will cut everything out, but the earthquake right here, you can see, here it is right here. Let's zoom in with the waveforms. Now you can start to see the earthquake. All right, there it is. There's the P wave, and the S wave starts right about here. So, very interesting earthquake. Barely was detected, but it did occur near Massachusetts Bay, actually pretty much within the bay. Now here we are back at earthquake.usgs.gov. As of 9:43 p.m. Pacific time, April 22nd, 2019, just looking. We do have a magnitude 6.0 near the South Sandwich Islands, which has been seeing a good increase in seismicity for 6.0s and 7.0s as of late. 93.6 kilometers in depth, somewhat deep. I believe that can be considered an intermediate depth earthquake. Then we had a 6.1 in the Philippines at 20 kilometers in depth with a strange did you feel it report in the red. Personally, I've never seen a red did you feel it report for a 6.1. Although this earthquake was only a magnitude 6.1 at 20 kilometers in depth in the Philippines, apparently 806 people actually reported to the USGS that they felt this, even though I do not believe that the USGS is authoritative in the Philippines, right? So that's surprising that 806 people would actually report feeling it to USGS themselves. Now notice here's the moment tensor, but it says a significant area was affected for liquefaction, extensive population exposed, but no landslides. Huh? That's very interesting. Usually you see at least some, if liquefaction's happening, usually you see at least some landslides. I don't know, maybe the country over there is very flat. I don't know, I've never been to the Philippines. There's the moment tensor right there. But again, very strange to see this much liquefaction and this strong of a did you feel it report just for magnitude 6.1. On the seismic stations at Yellowstone, you know, it didn't look too large, like for the teleseism. I mean, I know it's far away, guys. I'm just saying, in regards to teleseism, if it's like a 7.0 or 8.0, it would look a lot stronger on the seismic stations in the United States. I don't know. Maybe it was more shallow. Maybe it was much more shallow than they are stating. Let's go to the Did You Feel It report for the 6.1 in the Philippines. Notice it was felt quite strong, guys. Quite strong. Oh, yeah. So let's go back, shall we? Let's go all the way back. Now, here in Washington State, there was a quarry blast right near me. My friend used to work at that quarry, so I know that's a quarry blast right there. But Mount Rainier did see a magnitude 1.0 and 9.2 kilometers in depth just to the west-southwest of the base. And another one just far to the south. Far to the south. Let's see, I think Goat Rock's volcano is right here or something like that, right? Mount Adams is here, Mount St. Helens, almost in the middle. Almost in the middle. It was a 1.2 at 4.7 kilometers in depth. Then we had one near Portland on the Columbia River, right down here on the border between Washington and Oregon. It was a 1.5 at 23.4 kilometers in depth, which to me suggests it's part of the normal subducting process that is going on right there. Okay, so here's the main course. We see, let me zoom in right here. Here's Vancouver Island, which sees a good amount of seismicity. We saw a magnitude 5.5 and a 4.6. The depth on the 5.5, I do not think was constrained correctly because a lot of them out here are reported to be 10 kilometers exactly. Now, 10 kilometers in depth exactly is also, coincidentally, the depth that USGS sets when they do not know what the depth is, basically. But then again, earthquakes can occur at 10 kilometers in depth exactly, so sometimes you just never know. Because they don't actually state whether the depth was incorrect or not. Sometimes they do, sometimes they don't. But we did have a 5.5, supposedly felt by a few people, and a 4.6. I'll show these in just a second. Let's go to the 5.5, go to the event page. The event page is pretty much not really noteworthy for the 4.6 at 3.0 kilometers in depth. Nothing much there. No digifuel reports. This one occurred at 2027 UTC, which would be 1:27 p.m. Pacific time, April 22nd, 2019. Then we have one that occurred, let's see, just about an hour and 20 minutes later or so. About an hour and 17 minutes, I'm going to say. Let's click on the event page to the magnitude 5.5, which isn't even close to the magnitude, almost magnitude 7, that occurred about 6 months ago, I believe it was. I believe it was about 6 months ago. Let's see. Again, 5.5, 10 kilometers in depth. Three people reported feeling it. The moment sensor's right there. That's all the information they gave us. They gave us an estimated intensity map, the shake map. But I want to see the digifuel reports. Three people reported feeling it. I understand it was a 5.5, and that's not a small earthquake, guys. That's not small. But three people reported feeling it. Very interesting. And it was far off the coast of Vancouver Island. Let's see. We see one person right there. Did anybody down in Washington feel it? No. Nope. Not seeing anybody. Let me zoom all the way out. All the way out. Oh, hello. Yes, someone in Bellingham. Notice the magnitude 5.5 occurring right here. We have one felt report right here, one right here in Vancouver, and one right here right near Bellingham, Washington. Very interesting, guys. So that's the magnitude 5.5. Let's go to origin. See what the closest seismic station is. I already know what the closest station is. I've already downloaded the data, but I just wanted to let you guys know, just so you know. I'm pretty sure I'm right. Let me see. Yes. Hole in the CN network broadband vertical dash dash location code. Took 21 seconds for this earthquake to arrive on the station. Remember, 21 seconds plus this, because this is the originating time, which they use the P and S wave arrival to understand when the earthquake actually occurred. All right, let's go check it out. And here you can see we have hole in the CN network and why it was labeled closest station. The earthquake occurred basically right here. Obviously, we can see that. Here we also have a few other stations in the CN network for Canada, BPEB, which are the stations that I'm streaming in Swarm. And then we have another one down here, NTKA. I believe I'm streaming that one as well as ETB and Borehole 012, which is far south. But again, Holb is the closest station. Now here we are in the seismic program Swarmed with Holb, CN, broadband vertical. Notice we do have the most recent data stream, as you will see in just a second. I turned persistent rescale off, got overlap set to 95 automatically, but I'm going to scroll this down just for a second. Show you I'm going to add a 1 Hz high pass filter to the 8th power. Press OK. All right, we got the strange filter set, and we do have some strange events occurring here as well. Multiples of them. Multiple. Check out the spectrogram, guys. Personally, I have never seen this on the seismic station Hope in the CN network. Some of these do not coincide with surrounding stations, I've checked. But some of them do. I don't know what these are. I don't know if they're earthquakes. I don't know if they're surface noise. But personally, I've never seen surface noise act like this. Or wind or anything that can occur on the surface. Never seen it act like this before. I mean, look at one of these bursts, guys. They kind of look like earthquakes, but then again, they don't. Maybe they're tiny earthquakes that are occurring right before the main 4.6 and 5.5. I don't know for sure. But let's go back to the spectrogram. Let's zoom out twice, shall we? Notice how many of them there are, guys. I'm going to pan this down just a little bit. All right, let's go forward. Notice how many of these, what I'm going to call microquakes, because in my opinion, they do look like microquakes, especially this one. A very high frequency. Some dominant lower frequencies, as you can see, but they just look weird. Their waveforms look weird, guys. They kind of do look like earthquakes. I don't know. You be the judge. I really have no idea what these could be, even if it was surface noise. But going forward, they were pretty strong. A lot of them. And I just lost it. There we go. Let's keep going forward. Notice how they started to die down, probably around 1330 UTC or so. Increases a little bit, slowly dies down throughout the day. Could be some other earthquakes throughout the mix, but not much. Keep going forward. Again, they keep diminishing. And notice how, as they diminish, their strength diminishes and their frequencies diminish as well. And now we're basically seeing them down in the lower frequency band. I thought that was interesting. I thought that was... Whoops. Whoopsie. Let me go down. Okay, so the first event was magnitude 4.6 at 3 kilometers in depth, right? Let's go to the waveforms real quick. That's this one right here. Now, I want you to understand something real quick. These two earthquakes, the 4.6 and the 5.5, in my opinion, are very, very weird. I want you to notice something. Notice the separation between the P wave arrival and the S wave arrival, which is probably around here somewhere in this area. This is the S wave, but I don't know exactly where it arrived. But I want you to notice the P wave has lower frequencies. Check this out on the spectrogram. What? Do you see that? The P wave on the vertical broadband station channel has lower frequencies, and then the frequencies rise towards the S wave. Do you see that? Look at this. Look at this thing. That doesn't even make sense. That's weird. I have never really seen it act like this ever. Of course, there's weaker frequencies going beyond 25 hertz. But you can see here the power remains right below 5 hertz for the P wave. And you can see that here as well. Look at that. Let me zoom in. That's the P wave, guys. Usually you see this on the S wave or surface waves, Love and Rayleigh waves. But for a P wave, in my opinion, or in my experience, I have never seen that. Of course, it could be possible because I'm not a professional, but that's very strange. Let's zoom out. Oh, sorry. Let's zoom out. Zoom back in. That is the magnitude 4.6 that supposedly occurred at 3.0 kilometers in depth. We see possible microquake right beforehand. Let's go forward. We see multiple tiny, tiny microquakes, probably maybe around the 1.0. 2.5 range, 1.0 to 2.5, but not over 2.5, that's for sure. Because this station is somewhat farther away from the epicenter. And let's see, can't see much right there because the background activity is pretty strong. Here's the magnitude 5.5, right here. Now, I want you to notice something again. Let's zoom in to the magnitude 5.5. Let's zoom into the P and S wave arrival. Look at this. I understand this station is somewhat far away from the epicenter. Took about probably around 26 seconds to arrive on this station from the time it occurred. But look, still, it should not have that strong of lower frequencies for the P wave. I thought that was very, very intriguing. I don't know why the P wave is looking like this. Very, very strange. I've never seen. Sorry, guys. Kind of repeating myself a little bit, but at least you know how strange I think it is. That is so weird. This is definitely one for the books, that's for sure. And you can obviously see, look how long this lasted, guys. Couple aftershocks. Going through. Not many aftershocks, though. Not many at all. If they are, they're very, very tiny. Not being able to be recorded by the seismic station. But again, here's the magnitude 5.5, which supposedly occurred at 10 kilometers in depth. Still don't know why. The P wave was only seeing lower frequencies. Usually the frequencies are a little bit higher. I don't know why. Once again, check out the dominant frequencies of the magnitude 5.5 of the P and S wave. Keep log frequency on. Notice between about 0.9 hertz, which is right around where the filter starts. And notice the strongest frequency is 1.5 hertz. And the frequencies go down from there. Log power back on. I want to go to the spectrogram and do just the P wave. Just the P wave. Notice, oh, my bad. Let me do just the P wave right here. Look at that. That's the P wave, guys. That is so weird. That is the weirdest P wave I've ever seen. Sorry, guys. Notice between 1 hertz and 2.2 hertz for the P wave. Very, very weird. So what do you think is going on up there? What is occurring? Could the events up there be connected to the ETS tremor events that are occurring right now down here in Washington State? Maybe the whole thing is starting to shift more. I don't know what. That's up for you guys to decide. Excuse me. And here we are back in the seismic program swarm. We have these stations again streaming from north all the way to south. And you can see this strange background tremor, the strange low frequency background tremor, which could be associated with increased slip, ETS, episodic tremor and slip. There could be some occurring up there off the coast of northern Vancouver Island that is causing this low frequency tremor. Because as you see, the farther you get south, even not too far, maybe even 20, 30, 40 kilometers, it starts to weaken. And right now is 10:11 p.m. Pacific time, which is 5:11 UTC. Notice there's about 10 to 20 seconds of a delay right here, but this is the most recent data. Not really seeing many earthquakes, but you do see two things coinciding right there, and you do see a little bit of an increase right there, so that could have been like a 1.0 earthquake, maybe 1.5, but that's it, folks. Again, don't forget to check out some of the new content on the pages under the how-to menu of my website. If you want to be able to monitor volcanic and tectonic hazard areas from the comfort of your own home, just know it is much easier than it sounds, and many pages on my website can aid you in doing so. We are about to enter an ETS episode in the next few months, and I will put updates out about them, basically because I live in the same state that they usually occur in. Now, ETS episodes are also theorized to increase the chance of a major earthquake. Well, the ETS events themselves don't really increase the chance. However, it is the same process that creates the ETS that could create a large earthquake. In my opinion, the ETS events will continue like this, possibly getting slightly stronger throughout the years until the Cascadia subduction zone megathrust earthquake happens. I have no idea when that will be, but for us Seattleites, a magnitude 7 on the Seattle fault is likely more dangerous for us here, which is supposedly quite overdue, seeing that it hasn't happened for 1,100 years, and the subduction zone ruptured at least twice since the Seattle Fault ruptured. So why is the Seattle Fault so overdue? We know it's not dead, but something must have stopped its usual slip process, but only temporarily. So keep your eyes open and monitor these areas with me, guys. Again, I'm updating a lot of stuff on my website, and I'll let you guys know when that happens. I will be back soon. Let me know what you think. Have a great night, and God bless.